Welcome back! My name is ballerscuba. This is Video Games Over Time! We are still in 1982. Today, we're going to talk about the E.T. video game. The story of the E.T. video game takes us back to Atari. We have, of course, talked about Atari before. They were responsible for hits such as Pong and Missile Command. We last talked about Atari in our last video on Millipede. We have also talked about E.T. the Extraterrestrial. The enormously popular film was discussed in its own video. Released in July 1982, the success of E.T. caught the eye of Warner Communications, Atari's parent company. Warner Communications negotiated with Steven Spielberg and Universal Pictures to obtain the exclusive rights to adapt the film into arcade and console video games. Atari reportedly paid $20 to $25 million for these rights, roughly $57.6 to $72 million in 2022. This was a high amount for the time. Reportedly, Atari CEO Ray Kasser thought this was a bad idea, saying that Atari had never turned a film into an action video game before. Atari began immediately looking to make a game for the Atari 2600, seeing an arcade game too difficult to create on the timeline they wanted. For the adaptation of E.T., Atari turned to Howard Scott Warshaw on July 27th. We have talked about Howard Scott Warshaw before. He was responsible for Yar's Revenge. Ray Kasser informed Warshaw that the game needed to be finished by September 1st in order to have the game ready for sale by the holiday season, just 36 days. Yar's Revenge, by comparison, had taken Warshaw 7 months. However, Kasser reportedly offered Warshaw $200,000, over $575,000 in 2022, and an all-expenses-paid vacation to Hawaii to create the game. Warshaw accepted the challenge. Warner Communications then flew Warshaw out to meet Steven Spielberg to discuss the project. Warshaw envisioned a game loosely based on the film's plot, with the player playing as E.T. on a quest to collect items while avoiding obstacles and antagonists. Spielberg reportedly did not like this idea, wanting something similar to Pac-Man. Warshaw wanted to make a more original game, though, so created the game that he had originally pitched. Warshaw was able to complete the game in time, so that Atari could release the game for the holiday season. Much like Yar's Revenge, the E.T. video game is not necessarily straightforward. So, a lot of information for the game is found in the manual, which spreads the description of the gameplay across 4 pages. While we will not read the manual here, any new player to the game should read the manual to get even a basic understanding of what is happening in the game. The video game does loosely follow the plot of the film. If you have not seen E.T. the Extraterrestrial and do not want its plot spoiled, now would be the time to stop watching. Thank you for watching, and I hope to see you in the next video. E.T. is an adventure game. The player plays as E.T., who must collect 3 objects in order to build an intergalactic telephone and phone home. These pieces are found in pits, also known as wells. E.T. must fall in these wells, collect the pieces, levitate out of the well, then go to the correct area to make the phone call. Once the phone call is made, E.T. must then go to the correct area before time runs out in order to get rescued. Any action that E.T. takes will cost energy. E.T. can replenish energy by picking up Reese's pieces. E.T. can also use 9 Reese's pieces to ask Elliot to get a piece of the telephone, or can save the candy for bonus points. There is a scientist and an FBI agent in the game to stop E.T. The scientist will abduct E.T. to conduct experiments, while the FBI agent will steal something, either a piece of the telephone or all the candy from E.T. Should E.T. run out of energy, E.T. will lose a life. Elliot will then revive E.T. until the player loses all three lives. The game comes with different difficulty settings that will adjust the speed and number of human enemies in the game. Atari released E.T. for the Atari 2600 in North America in December 1982. That is the backstory to the E.T. video game. With that now told, it's time to play the game for ourselves. Here we are in the game. This is E.T. for the Atari 2600. As you can see, we do get a title screen. We don't always get those in Atari 2600 games. Now, this game is a complicated game, and if you have not read the manual, you're not going to understand what's happening. There's a lot of hidden messages and codes in the game that we're going to have to explain. So, in order to explain that, I'm going to change it to game mode 3. Game mode 1 here has both the FBI agent and the scientist. We're going to not want that, because it's too complicated for me to explain anything. Game mode 2 just has the FBI agent, it doesn't have the scientist. I think that is the worst of the two to show up, but maybe that's just me. I still don't want that to happen. I want game mode 3. In game mode 3, there are no human antagonists. That'll make it easy for me to explain, so let's head in and see what we can do in E.T. Alright, so we start in the forest screen, and I kind of need to explain from the beginning what's going on. That's how kind of weird this all is. So, we are in the forest. I think that the dark green represents the actual trees. I'm not entirely sure. We have 9,999 energy at the bottom of the screen, and we are in a zone on the screen. And you can tell that we're in a zone because there is a little symbol in that pink kind of purplish bar at the top. That zone would be the landing zone. You can tell because there's basically like a reticle there. As we move around, what zone we're in on the screen will change. If I go to the right here, I believe, yes. That will change the screen, well, the little symbol to an arrow. This is a warp zone. Should I hit a button here, I will warp to the screen to the left. Now, the way that this is designed is a six-sided die. It is a very complicated world map screen that I've never fully grasped, to be honest, but we're going to hit the button, the fire button, and we will warp to the screen to the left. Now we're on a screen with the pits. These are the important things. They're also the most aggravating things in the game. We're going to grab that Reese's piece first. And as we move around, you can see that the zone that we're in on the screen changes. This one right here will allow us to eat the Reese's piece that we just picked up. And we can restore our health. You can only do that on that part of the screen. If you're in that zone, then you can do it. What I'm going to look for here is a question mark. And if I can find the question mark zone, then I will be happy. We can also sprint using the fire button. Oh, here is a call Elliot zone. The call Elliot zone will call Elliot. I'm gonna try it here because I believe he just takes your Reese's pieces if you don't have the 9 required. Oh no, he didn't do that. Maybe you have to be on a different screen for that. Oh, here comes Elliot. Yeah, he just took my Reese's piece. He's not going to find anything for me. You need 9, so don't press the button. Otherwise, Elliot just steals your candy. This question mark, though, will let us know if there is a phone piece on this screen. So we're going to hit the button here. There's a little flash. So down this pit is a phone piece. We're going to go ahead and grab it. And now for the trickiest part of the game, getting out of the pit. The way you want to do it is you want to hold the fire button. And once E.T.'s neck is fully extended, hit up, like this. When you get out, hold the fire button and move E.T. away from the pit. Don't let go of the fire button until E.T. is no longer touching the pit. That's how you do it. It's very tricky. And despite the practice that I've had, I'm still not good at it. I'm gonna go ahead and eat that. All right, let's go this way. It doesn't really matter. All right, let's see if we can find another zone to describe what is going on here. Ah, here we go. This is the building zone. If a human enemy is coming at you and you are in this zone, you can hit the button and I'll send them back to their building. We will see the buildings at some point. Don't know when. Hoping to find the question mark zone. Oh, there it was. There is no phone on this screen. No phone piece on this screen. All right. And we'll go ahead and grab that. And to the left here is phone piece number two. Let's see if I can get out of here. They didn't let me do it. We'll try it on the right side this time. There we go. All right, can I eat my candy? But we do have two pieces of the phone. You can tell because now it's an E. There, I can eat my candy. And we should go somewhere else. Okay. Go ahead and grab that. I don't like sprinting too much in this game. This picture here of the Space Invader, I think is supposed to represent aliens, because this is the phone home zone on the screen. That's going to be an important one to remember, because we actually need to do that in order to win. Let's see if I can find the question mark somewhere here. There it is. All right, bottom left. There we go. Hit that, and let's see if I can get out of here. Not that time. I mistakenly hit left, just holding it, thinking that it would spawn me on that side. Okay. Now we can phone home. Actually, before we do that, let's head down here. It should take us to the buildings. It does. All right, so these are the buildings. Let me get my health back a little bit. The one on the left is the FBI building. The one on the right is the scientist building. And this house here is Elliot's place. This is where they will go if you hit the button in the building zone on the screen and they're on your screen, you'll send them back here. If the scientist captures you, he takes you to that right one there. And this is where Elliot comes from in order to try to find a phone piece for you if you have nine, but I never have nine. All right, wasn't there a... Yes, there was this here, so we're going to hit the button and summon my friends. Now we need to go back to the loading zone in time. The problem is that the loading zone changes. That's the eating zone. There we go. Landing zone is here. So this is where you're going to want to be when your friends show up. One of the difficult things about this game, though, is that you need to hold on to, I believe, all of the telephone pieces in order for your friends to show up. And I do believe that nobody else can be on the screen, depending on your game mode, when they show up. But here they come. And we have won. And that is how you win E.T. We have 9,572 points. I honestly have no idea if that's a good score, but we won. So let's go ahead and try to do it on the normal difficulty now. And you can already see some of how the game is just kind of set up strangely. Now we're going to aggravate that by having enemies and basically a time crunch going for me. So let's go ahead and turn it to game mode one again and head in and see what I can do. I haven't actually been able to beat the game on game mode one yet, so I'm hoping for the best. All right, we're gonna need to sprint here because we have issues going on. All right, let's see if they will let me out of here. We got one phone piece already. FBI agent is chasing me. I'm going to send him away. I happen to be in the zone. I lucked out there. All right, where is the question mark zone? There it is. All right, over here, scientist is after me. Scientist, I don't mind all that much. It's the FBI agent that I'm concerned about. Okay, that way. Get that back. All right, down here is number two. Did the FBI agent get me? I think the FBI agent got me. Because now that should have been number three, yeah? I also should have gotten out of that. All right, if the scientist got me, that's okay. Yeah, he's not chasing me. He must have gotten a piece at some point because I thought I was already good. If you know what you're doing, it's not a long game. Didn't mean to do that. I don't know what I'm doing, clearly. You can beat it in like a minute, if things go your way. And down a pit immediately. I think it's on that screen, though. The problem is that the FBI agent keeps on chasing me. All right, it is in here. Oh, nope, I can't. I was too high. I can't do that from there. All right, all three down. Nope. Let's try it again. This time I'm going to go slightly to the right, and then we'll see what we can do. Come on now. This is not nice. Okay. Nope. Can't summon from there. You can't summon from the from that screen as far as I can tell. And down a pit again. I have six, but I can't find a zone where I can eat them. There we go. We're doing all right. Where is phone home? Ah! No! No! That was not the zone that I was in! I have all three pieces. I'm in the zone. Do they not let me do it if somebody is on the screen? And he took a piece. And I've been captured. I was so close! Alright. It's in here. Okay. Let's get this. And get out of here. Try to find a zone where I can call. Okay. They won't let me do it if somebody's on the screen. That's my best guess. You can't call from there. You can see how frustrating this gets very quickly. Where do I phone from? And he instantly shows up and takes my shit. I needed that. Okay, send him away. Where's the question mark? If he's stuck on the screen, that is good for me. He's not in the question mark zone though, is he? Like, where are all the zones here? All right, well, there's that one. If he's stuck, that's good for me at this point. There it is. It's not on the screen. Damn it. Not on this screen. Don't call Elliot. And you took another piece from me! He spawned on top of me and took another piece! You can see how frustrating this gets. Okay, that is it. And I got caught again. Don't hit any buttons while this happens because you will still lose points if you try to move while he's on you like that. Nothing here. Go away. Don't take a piece. Not here. Oh, here? No. Damn it! Oh, we're so close so many times, and then something happens. Yeah, he can just walk over pits, too. You really have to learn how to sprint well in this. Okay. No! I'm just gonna start warping. All right. No! Damn it! That's the problem with warping, is that you end up losing a lot of energy by falling down the pit. You lose so much by falling down the pit. I feel like we're getting there, but we're not. We're not. I only have two pieces. I don't have any Reese's pieces left. It gets frustrating so quickly. Not here. That's not what I wanted to do at all. I wanted to find Not here. Down a pit because I don't even know where they put me, but close enough to touch the thing. Okay, if somebody shows up, we can go. Go away. No! Go away! Okay, he's stuck. Is he in the zone that I need to be in? I don't know where it is, but I can't, like, touch him, otherwise I will get caught. Yep, he was right there. Go away. Not here either. Down another pit. Where'd they hide the phone piece? Okay, we already checked in here. I keep on doing that. I'm gonna die soon. Just run out of energy because I can't find this other phone piece. All right, it's gotta be in here. Yes. Okay, there's the last one. Nope. You see how much you lose. It's like 250 energy by falling down. Nope. Where's a phone zone? And I've died. Well, at least we get to show this off. Elliot just comes and revives you. You get 1500 energy back. But that is not enough. You can't phone from here. Trust me, I've looked. Where's a phone zone? That's not what I wanted, and you know it. Yeah, once you start dying, it's very difficult to get back. That doesn't... Yeah, you can't call while somebody else is on the screen. And I'm pretty sure I'm dying here. And they put me down in the pit while I died. Once you die the first time, it's very difficult to come back. Very, very difficult. I'm not even sure what happened. They just decided you were dead. Okay. He didn't get me. Is there a phone zone here? Can I call home? Not Elliot. Home. Can't do it here. We've tried. I'm gonna lose. Because I can't find a spot. Yep, that's it. Oh, well, I just instantly got revived there. I don't think I've ever died outside of a pit before. Elliot didn't come and save me. Where can I call from? If somebody's on the screen, then it doesn't help me any. Yeah, I don't remember all the zones. Some of them don't have a phone home zone. And I'm running out of life again because I can't find a spot where I can call from. Yeah, just go ahead because I'm not gonna live. All right, and I have died, and I think my point total is 3. And I think that is enough of the game. That is E.T. Now Played. With the game played, let's talk about how it holds up today. Playing the game today, I do have to say that the game is not fun, and that's probably not a surprise to anybody. The game is not designed well. I would say that the game is difficult just to learn. You have to read the manual. You have to understand what all the symbols on the screen mean just to figure out what you're doing. And that's not a good style for an Atari 2600 game. Atari 2600 games are not very complicated. They're not very large. And as a result, they need to be straightforward. And anytime that you're going to make things kind of complicated, you're going to scare a lot of people off. Atari 2600 games are kind of meant to be pick up and play. And this is not a game you can pick up and play. It requires study. It requires reading the manual, then playing the game, then probably reading the manual again, then playing the game, and then probably putting them next to each other to try to figure out what is going on. Overall, though, once you figure out the zones on the screen, it becomes a little bit easier to try to figure out what is happening. But the design of the world itself, to have these six different screens that are arranged like a die and will show up in different iterations, like you can see it in different perspectives depending on which screen you came from in order to get there, it reverses everything that you're looking at. That's not a good design. It makes it very difficult. And it was something that I never got used to. The fact that if I came to the forest from the bottom, it was reversed forest screen from when I came from it from the top. That was very difficult for me to try to sort out. And then, of course, the way that the zones are laid out are very difficult for you to try to figure out where you need to go in order to make things happen. There was only one spot that I had memorized that was a phone home zone, and that was on the screen with the buildings. But the screen with the buildings is where the humans are the most often. And when I was practicing playing the game, because I had to practice just to get as good as what you saw, every time I tried to get caught by the scientist, then run over to the phone home zone so that I could call, the FBI agent showed up every time. So that was the only zone that I knew where I could phone home, and it was not useful because of how it ended up working out for me. I knew there were other ones on the screens with the pits, but they were difficult to find. And I couldn't find it in this latest run through because I didn't have it memorized. There's so many zones on each screen that it makes it very difficult to play. And keep in mind, there's actually a harder difficulty than what I showed you. I could have made the humans faster, and that would have made things so much worse. The game is complicated, and it doesn't convey itself well to the player. And that is the biggest problem. The other biggest problem is getting out of the pit. Why it's designed in a way that you can levitate out of the pit, and then when it puts you above the pit, it spawns you literally on top of the pit instead of just putting you on the ground outside of the pit. I don't know why. That makes it so frustrating when you're trying to get out. And for a lot of new players that aren't familiar with getting out of the pit, you're going to end up in a cycle where you're trying to get out of the pit and you're just falling down over and over and over again, and then you die. And that's not going to be fun for anybody. The game is frustrating. And although it was relatively easy, I guess you could say, the first time that I played it without any of the human enemies, it was because I had practiced. It was because I already knew what I was doing. It was because I was trying to explain things. But adding the enemies makes all the small problems with the game so much worse. It makes the pits so much more frustrating. It makes the idea of trying to find random phone parts in the game so much more frustrating when somebody can just take one. I don't know why the FBI wants phone parts, but they just keep hiding them back in the pits, and then it starts not making sense from a plot perspective or a world-building perspective. So overall, the game is not good, and that's probably not a surprise to anybody. The sounds are not good. Graphics are not good. The fact that they did have something similar to an E.T. theme in it, I wouldn't say it was exactly the theme, but they were very close. That is really good. But other than that, the sound was bad. But overall, the design of the game suffered from Howard Scott Warshaw trying to make something more complex than the Atari 2600's audience could handle, but also that the game, the console itself, really was meant to make. And of course, the time crunch that we talked about for Howard Scott Warshaw made the game very bad. I wouldn't necessarily say it's as bad as a lot of people say, because this is kind of a legendary game, and we'll talk a little bit more about that later. I wouldn't say it's that bad, but it's pretty bad. I have played much worse games than this, though. This game just is difficult to understand, but even if you do understand it, it's mediocre. That's my modern take on the game. So would I recommend it to anybody? The answer largely is no. That is not something that I would recommend for people, but I would say that there is a small bit of curiosity about this game that's going to keep people coming back to it, because this game is very important, which is also something that we will talk about in a bit. But because the game is so important, there are going to be people that try to look at this game and try to see for themselves if they agree with the assessment of the game. And for those people, I would recommend checking it out and reading the manual and going through the steps necessary to play a game without, you know, casting judgment on just trying to pick it up and play it. But if you're not one of those people that aren't, you know, curious in, you know, some of the worst games of all time or some of the most important games of all time, I would stay away from this game. It's not going to be fun for you. It's more of an interest than it is entertainment. And that's my modern take on the game. When Atari released the game, Atari anticipated the game to be a huge success. It is reported that Atari created between 4 and 6 million copies of the game. At the end of 1982, there were roughly 15 million Atari 2600 consoles, meaning that Atari anticipated that roughly a third of all Atari 2600 owners would purchase the ET video game. The game would be popular, selling over 2.5 million copies by the end of 1982, but it would fall far short of Atari's expectations. While there were some issues with distribution, the problem with the game's sales fell on the game itself. Millions of copies would go unsold, and hundreds of thousands of copies that were sold were returned. What would become of the unsold and returned cartridges would become an urban legend that we will discuss in a later video. The critics were very negative about E.T. The graphics, the gameplay, and the story were all cited as negative aspects of the game. In particular, the constant falling into pits was seen as the worst aspect of the game. Some would go as far as to say that E.T. was one of the worst games for the Atari 2600. As time has gone on, the game has been considered one of, if not the worst video game of all time. However, it is arguably also one of the most important. The impact and importance of this game comes from the combination of its low quality and its popularity. E.T., despite its bad reputation, was still one of the best-selling Atari 2600 games of all time. E.T. is often cited as one of the major turning points in the video game industry. When the largest video game company, Atari, and one of the most popular films, E.T., team up to make something that is received so negatively, it is bound to have wide-ranging effects. We will explore those effects as we continue. As for Atari itself, we will see the impact of the successes and high-profile failures that the company had in 1982 as we continue moving forward. As for Howard Scott Warshaw, he had actually created another game in 1982, which we will mention in our honorable mentions video. E.T. would actually be the final game Warshaw created that would be released. While Atari gave him another project, it would not be completed. After the honorable mentions video, we will not be hearing from Howard Scott Warshaw again. That will do it for the story of the E.T. video game for now. My name is ballerscuba. This has been Video Games Over Time. Thank you so much for watching, and I hope to see you in our next video when things get dark. Thank you.